Would you look at your neighbor real quick and say, give me a little room, Lucille, I might bust a move. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I'm going to try to say a lot of stuff tonight real quick, but you need to receive this right now. Only your intolerance of your present situation can change it. You're never going to change what you're not willing to confront. We are on a fool's journey to think we can just go to some kind of special meeting and jump and carry on and gymnastics for Jesus and boogaloo and throw down and what have you, as if it's going to fit. No, no, no. The change factor is within us. You'll never change what you believe until what you believe can't change you. Hallelujah. Honored to be with you. Thank you, my good friend Gordon Poe, and the wonderful vision God gave you for this meeting. And Brother White, wow, my God, you preached a cover off the Bible last night. That was phenomenal. Was that some kind of preaching or what? Woo! Now I've got to go quick because for no reason at all. I pastor people, not a lot of them, just a handful of them, the ones that these I'm going to talk about. I pastor people that come to church with leaving on their mind. As if they were going to a dentist office and said, this won't take long, and it won't cost much, and I hope it doesn't hurt. I don't ever go to church with leaving on my mind. I got no place to go. And if this be your last service, you say, oh, no, you never know. Some idiot will shoot you in a McDonald's. You'll have an aneurysm on the way home. Somebody will blow your brains out. You think you've got tomorrow. You ain't got no tomorrow. You got this moment. This moment. So if this be your last moment, why don't you make it a memorial? Twenty-five to 9, your time. 25 to 12, my time. My Geritol kicks in at 10. Honored to be with you. Let me direct your attention to the word of the Lord. If you have your Bible, I'd like to go to the book of Judges, chapter 7, real quick. I don't think I've ever done this. Now, I don't want you to get offended. I know we're on WorldNet and all that kind of foolishness. Fine, that's great. I have no problem. I don't think I've ever done this. I went to preach at a national convention just recently, and I did terribly. I mean, I wouldn't have bought my tape. Normally, I buy my tape if I can. But it was horrible. I messed the whole sermon up, got sidetracked, distracted. That's okay. And the Lord dealt with me and said, preach it again right this time. Now, see, you folks get upset when you hear a preacher and you hear the preacher and I have people and they say, oh, I've heard him preach that. I said, well, I've heard your dumb choir sing that. Why is that the choir can sing the same songs over again and the preacher can't preach the same sermon over again? So I'm going to try my best right now. I'm looking to Judges chapter 7, verse 7. And the Lord said unto Gideon, by the 300 that men that have lapped will I save you and deliver the Midianites into thine hand. And let all the other people go, every man unto his place. So the people took victuals in their hand, their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man unto his tent, and retained those 300 men, and the host of Midian was beneath him in the valley. came to pass. Now, you got to get this, because this is powerful. It came to pass that the same night that the Lord said unto him, arise, get thee down unto the host, for I have delivered it into thine hand. Now look at me real quick. Okay, look at me. That's what we're all wanting. We're wanting to get a word from the Lord. We're wanting to get a promise from the Lord. Now, if you fellas disagree with me, fine. But I have the mic. I'm going to make a statement. You ready? The promise of God ain't enough. And getting a rhema word from the Lord won't fix it. Now, I'm going to show it to you in just a second. He turned around, watch. He says, arise, get thee down, I've delivered it into thy hand. But if thou fear to go down, go thou with fear of thy servant down to the host, and thou shalt hear what they say, and afterward thine hand shall be strengthened to go down unto the host. Now, here's what God just said to him. In case you think I'm lying, I didn't even get a burp. Now, let me try it again. I have delivered the Midianites into your hand. But if you're afraid to go down, why? Because you think I'm lying. You don't think I'm going to do what I promised you to do. Then I'll let your faith come from people that don't even live for me. Watch what he says. And he says, and you'll be strengthened, you'll go down. Verse 12, and the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along in the valley like grasshoppers for multitude, their camels without number, sand as the sand by the seaside for multitude. When Gideon was come, behold, there was a man that told a dream unto his fellow and said, behold, I dreamed a dream, and a cake of barley bread tumbled into the host of Midian. That's a cupcake, a barley, that's a cupcake. He said, I dreamed this dream, and this cupcake rolled into the tent. He said, the cake of barley rolled in, and it came to pass that when it hit the tent, it smote it, that it fell, and it overturned it, and the tent lay along. Now watch. His fellow says, his fellow guard, now these people ain't saved. These people are not redeemed. These people are pagans. You need to get off this kick that God only gives dreams and visitations to Pentecostals. God can talk to anybody he wants to talk to. Now watch what he says. And his fellow answered and said, why, this is nothing else save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, the man of Israel. For into his hand hath God delivered the Midianites and all the hosts. And it was so that when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, he worshipped. Now, he didn't worship when God told him. Because, you don't know whether he's telling the truth or not. You can't. But now I got this pagan heathen. He told a dream, and now I'm going to break out and worship. Kind of like we tell you what the Bible says, it don't matter. CNN tells you something, and you go, whoa. Watch this. And Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, and he worshipped and returned unto the host of Israel and said, arise, for the Lord has delivered it into your hand. I am out of time, and I'm just getting started. I got to say a lot of stuff, so I'm going to stop all the reading, and I'll just quote the rest of it. Lord, bless the teaching. In Jesus' name I pray. Loose the power of God. Let the gifts of the Spirit operate. Let signs and wonders and miracles take place in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Sorry for keeping you standing so long. I want to talk to you about the awesome power of a picture. An awesome power of a picture. Now, I don't want to be offensive to anybody. I'm going to do my very best to be kind, gentle Jeffrey. Okay? But you got to hear me. The promises of God are not self-fulfilling. We all say, if we could just get a word from the Lord, we could just get a promise from the Lord. Well, they don't fulfill themselves. Let me help you with this. The promises of God are simply revelations of divine intention. When God gives you a promise, he goes on record and says, and this is what I plan to do. And then he says, now what do you plan to do? Well, we were doing so good when the music was playing and the choir was throwing down. What happened to the Jubilee people that was here a minute ago? God did not choose through the foolishness of singing to save people. He chose through the foolishness of preaching to save people. Please be seated. I'm going as quickly as I can. God gave me a word a few years ago when him and I were preaching in that meeting down way down in Texas, and I've never forgot it. I was on the platform getting ready to preach, and the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, if you can convince these people, I will confirm my word. So the problem is not me, and it ain't him. I'm going to do what I can in a few minutes to try and convince you. And if you can get convinced, God's already convinced. God wants to break out here like a wave and start healing people and saving people and blessing people and delivering people. But we need more than a promise. Please be seated. Now look, this thing's going to get real long if you keep doing this jumping bean stuff. Okay, I mean, I'm happy for you to do it, fine. But I don't run out of time. Time don't mean nothing to me. I'm serving one that said, behold, I come quickly. Apparently, time don't bother him either. I'm glad he didn't say it wasn't going to take his time. Listen to me. Promises are not enough. Why? Because Israel was pregnant with promises and died outside the promised land. They spent all those years walking around in the wilderness over their disobedience, pregnant with the word of God, pregnant with the intentions of God, and they died outside like a generation of Pentecostals that we're trying to get saved from, that are walking around holding the promise and say, well, I got a promise. You got to have more than a promise. The promise has to become fulfilled. Your faith has got to grab a hold of that promise and said, I believe that. Now look, we got too many people in this building for me to give an altar call when we need an altar call. So look, you're going to have to build your altar right where you are. When I start saying something and something clicks, you need to reach up and snatch hold of that and say, that's for me. I'm going to pull that down and I'm going to believe God to touch me. You don't need a preacher to lay hands on you. You don't need a special altar call. You just need to believe that the promise is yours. Sister, stay. Just stay with me just for a second. Just for a second. So Israel dies pregnant with promises because promises ain't enough. I told you, promises are revelation what God intends. In the scripture that I read to you, and I had another one I want to read about the story of Naaman. We've already heard about Naaman getting healed and getting fixed up and getting flesh, a child of a flesh and all that stuff. But do you understand what the key to the promise is? The key to make the promise work is a picture. See, now I figured that's just what I was going to get for a response. A picture? Yeah, you see, without the picture, the promise doesn't work. The promise is just words that don't make much sense, that give you a little hope. But if you can ever let the promise be transformed into a picture, you can relate to that picture and you can say, I see that. I get that. I believe that. I'm going after that. I'm going to try to preach over here in this section just for a little, okay? Listen to me. I'm not doing so good over here. I'm going to come over here. You ready? God gave Gideon a promise. Sit down. God, now choir, I worshiped with you. God gave Gideon a promise. He said, I've delivered the Midianites into your hand, but in case you're afraid. That was a polite way of saying, you may be finding it hard to believe me because the odds are against you and not for you. So he says, here's what I'm going to do. If the promise doesn't provoke you, the picture will. What do you think that dream was? It was a picture. What do you think the interpretation was? It was a picture. He did not respond to the promise, but he did respond to the picture. Can you imagine? You can sit down getting ready to go to a war, and you're outnumbered 10 or 20 to 1, and the Lord says, all you need is a picture. He says, here, go down and listen to Midianites. And he talks to them about a cupcake. I mean, a guy just gets on duty. You know, how you doing, Bill? Fine. How you doing, Charlie? What's going on? You know, I had this crazy dream. I said, I dreamed this barley cake, cupcake, come rolling down the hill. Really? Yeah, and it hit the tent stake and knocked the tent down and wiped the whole camp out. Really? And the other guy goes, Ungawa. Hi-yabba, ha, ha, ha. Said, what's the matter, Charlie? I just got the interpretation to the cupcake. Now, you got to hear me. It may not be funny to you unless you're the cupcake hiding in the bushes. You are closer to your miracle than you could imagine. You are nearer to your answer than you could imagine. You are a picture away from the performance of the promise. You can be seated. You can be seated. I'm going back over here. You people are friendly. You ready? He says, interpretation. What is it? The cupcake is Gideon. Gideon. He said, the Lord has delivered the whole camp of Midian into his hands, and he breaks out worshiping. Why? Because when the promise doesn't convince you, the picture can convince you. If you can see it, you can have it. If you can see it, it can become a reality. But you've got to see it in picture form. Woo. You're never going to get saved till you see yourself saved. You're never going to get healed till you see yourself healed. You're never going to get delivered till you see yourself delivered. Where's my friend Gordon Poe? Where'd he go? Poe's out taking up another offering. You ready for this? I'm not, please don't get offended, brethren, sisterin. I'm not a golfer. I ain't against it. I just ain't no good at it. And I'm not playing nothing that's better than me. I'm not paying $50 to chase a ball that won't go where I told it to go. But I read this article, and that's where this message came from. It was a quote from Jack Nicklaus, the world champion golfer, the Golden Bear. And he turned around and he said, you know, they asked him, how did you win so many championships? And how did you do so well? He said, oh, that's easy. I see every shot in my mind before my body gets involved. He said, I even see every shot that I'm getting ready to hit in practice. He said, when I get ready to address the ball, I look at the ball, I look at where I want to go, and my mind lets the picture govern my body's response. I wonder what would happen in the next few minutes if your mind could be persuaded by a picture of what God wants to do for you, and your body would respond. Well, I'm going to resurrect the rest of you, sweetie. You don't know like I know what he's done for me. I said, you don't know like I know how he set me free. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He established my going. He put a song in my mouth, even praise unto the Lord. I got a picture that I'm coming out of this. You can sit down. You can sit down. I'm trying to help you. Anybody and everybody in this house that you need a healing touch in your body, listen to me. I'm not trying to be offensive, brethren. Please don't be offended. I'm not. You do not need me to lay my hand on you. You need to let the picture develop in your mind. If you and I can see ourselves coming to Jesus like those people did in the Bible, we can get what they got in a moment. Now, I'm just going to make a little disclaimer here. In California, don't be offended, brethren. You ain't got to have everything right in your life to get a touch from God. You can have some dirty laundry in your life. You can have some past failures. But I know somebody who can overwhelm and overcome your failure and give you faith to believe that the promise is mine because I got a picture. You can be seated. I'm going as fast as I can. This has bugged me. He said, I get a sharp focus picture in my mind. And so once it's in my mind, my body aligns with the picture. Now you're not getting it yet, but you will in a second. Gideon's got a promise, but he doesn't have a picture. If there's one, not a complaint, just an observation that I have found about us Holy Roller folks. We are like Israel. We are pregnant with so many promises, but we're frustrated because they're not happening. You know why? You need to ask God to let the promise become a picture. If you can see the picture, you can gravitate towards it. You can believe it. You can embrace it. Because sometimes promises are just words. Sometimes promises seem outlandish and almost impossible. But if God can give you a picture, am I talking to anybody here? Please be seated. Real quick. You're going to wear the crease out in your britches here. Just hold on here. You ready for this? Have you ever had someone try to describe something for you? And you have that perplexed, I don't understand kind of look on your face. And they say, didn't you get the picture? Now, when I used to be real bad and disobedient in trouble with the police all the time, and my dad used to whip me and correct me, he would say, boy, what's the matter with you? Do I have to paint you a picture? Now, he gave me all these words, gave me all these threats, gave me all these things. I didn't get it. He said, I got to paint you a picture. Don't you understand? Somebody explaining something to you right now. I'm trying to explain something to you, and I want to say, don't you get the picture? Don't you get the picture? I love you with an everlasting love. Don't you get the picture? I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll never put on you more than you can bear. With every test and every trial, I'll make a way of escape. I'm with you even to the end of the age. Don't you got the picture? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Don't you have the picture? No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. See, sit down. Sit down. I'm not trying to be a cheerleader for Jesus. I am trying to see if I can move a few people that seem to be super glued to your seat. I know it ain't all in the emotion, boys and girls. I know that. I know it ain't all in the shouting and the amen and the hallelujah. I know that. Now, a little rude, but I'm preparing you. And it ain't all in the sitting and the staring either. Now, if God has never done anything for you, just sit there with your mouth closed. But if he ever answered a prayer, if he ever made a way where there was no way, if he ever came through when you didn't expect him to come through, at least you can say, thank you. Woo! Woo! You can be seated. I'm going as fast as I can. You understand? It was Albert Einstein who made this great statement. He said, imagination is much greater and more powerful than knowledge. He said, for if you can see it in your mind, your imagination and the picture in your mind can take you beyond the facts. The fact is, the doctor said you've got cancer and you're going to die. But getting a picture, I got a heel that says, come unto me, all ye that heavy laden. Going to give you rest. I got a picture, baby. I don't care what the diagnosis was. I'm going for a second opinion. I'm going to the great physician. He can fix anything. He can heal anybody. He can turn anything around. He can make a way where there is no way. You can sit down. You can sit down. I'm not trying to do no cheerleading for Jesus. Am I making sense to help you? That's all I want. Do you understand that the greatest of all, the master creator of the universe, watch this, never create anything with his mouth shut. Now he's got all power, he's almighty, all wise, all knowing. He never made anything until he opened his mouth. Only the Pentecostals think they can get something with their mouth closed. Death and life is in the power of the tongue. Yeah, you and me, seen it. I'm trying my very best not to be unkind. I got a big leash on my neck. I'm asking God to help me. I don't want to be unkind. I pastor a wonderful church, have a very fine, fine church. But we have people in our church that don't think like me. And one Sunday morning, I was throwing down, baby. I was smoking. I mean, I almost preached my socks off, man. I almost bought my own tape. I mean, I was sweating so bad, and the place went up in smoke, and here I come up with this very sweet lady, been with us 40 years. She knows more Bible than the Bible. And she comes up to me, and I'm just elated, man. I'm throwing down. I'm doing the Watusi. I can make up some moves, baby. It don't bother me. And she walked up to me. She said, you know, Brother Arnold, all this emotion and all this talking in tongues and all this jumping high and hanging, running crazy. She says, I don't think it takes all that. I said, I do. I'm fighting devils. I'm fighting demons. I'm fighting my flesh. I'm fighting my imagination. I'm fighting my lust. I am not going to sit by. If you can do it at a ball game, I ought to be able to do it in church. He brought me out. He turned me around. He's given me an inheritance. Woo. Please be seated. I'm trying not to be mean. Listen, girls, you're on the front row. You got trouble. She says, I just don't think it takes all that. She says, I don't see why we have to have all this shouting and this noise and all this excitement. I said, you think we ought to be quiet? You think we ought to be orderly? Well, yes, I do. I said, why don't you take a trip to Arlington Cemetery? Everything is quiet, everything is in order, and everything is dead. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. We're going somewhere, baby. The best is yet to come. You ain't seen nothing yet. You wait till the Lord spits the eastern sky. You wait till he snatches us out of here. You wait till you get your glorified body. You talk about a party. You can be seated. Sorry. Didn't mean to wake everybody up at once. You ready? Maybe if you can keep the picture of the coming of the Lord in your mind, it will help you not to fall into sin. It will help you not to become bitter. It will help you to keep your prayer life alive. You just don't need a promise. You need a picture. Sit down. I'm sorry. I realize, sisterin, brethren, preacherin, I realize I just did something that you have no Bible for. I've been challenged and condemned and railed on when I take off doing a little running. I said, I can't believe you run in church. I said, I can't believe you sit in church. Say, well, you ain't got no Bible for running in church. I said, you ain't got no Bible for not clapping. You ain't got no Bible for not lifting up your voice like a trumpet and magnifying. I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving. I will enter into his courts with praise. I will be thankful and bless his name. I'm sorry. I got to say this. I don't remember whether I said this 2 or 3 years ago or not. I want to say it again. We got a $69 million Florida lottery. Now, that's for people who don't work, who hope they win. $69. Get the picture. Somebody from the lottery board calls you tonight at 11:45. Is this Alice Jane Spa Harbor, 5225 Milky Way Drive? Well, yes, it is. Well, they just picked out your winning number for the lottery, and you just won six. Now, you all realize you're too saved to play. But you got a backslidden relative playing a trick on you. And they paid $2 for that ticket, and they picked your name. Now, let me see if I can get us together now. Get the picture. You just won $69 million, and being a good California Pentecostal, you went, well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't mean to be rude, but baby, If you be in your pajamas, if you've got 1,453 rollers in your head, you got 6 pounds of mud on your face, and they told you you won $69 million, you'd bust that out of the... You'd run down the street in your underwear, sir, if you just won $69 million. You don't give a flip about your friends. $69 million, you can buy new friends. Now you're laughing because it's humorous. Wait a minute, sit down. Here's the next prize. Sir, ma'am, I'm going to pick on you, Blondie, okay? You don't mind, do you? I'm not picking you up, but I'm picking on you. You're close, okay? And he says, you won the other prize. You just won an all-expense-paid trip around the world with 2 weeks in Hawaii. Being the great praiser and worshiper of God you are, glory. Hallelujah. That devil is a liar. If you ever get the picture, your emotion will explode. You ready for this, Brother White? We have not won a trip around the world. We have won a trip to New Jerusalem. I'm going to the city where the Lamb is the light. I'm going to the city where there never is a night. There's no devil. There's no disease. There's no sickness. There's no hospital. There's no cemetery. There's no tempter. It's joy unspeakable, and it's full of glory. Did you get the picture? Let me just preach a few more minutes and I'm going to stop. You got to hear me. Pictures are so powerful. Pictures can provoke you when promises don't. You get the picture. You see, if you don't remember anything else I said tonight, remember this. Okay? You are never going to possess what you're unwilling to pursue. We can sit on our backside in the church service all night long, angels doing backflips, Elijah riding through on his chariot, won't move us one bit. If we do not pursue what we've been promised, we're no better than Bartimaeus when Jesus is walking by and Bartimaeus, being a good Pentecostal, doesn't say anything. He doesn't shout. He doesn't scream. He doesn't whistle. No. Why? The attitude of some. Well, he knows where I am. Yeah, he's going to let you stay there too. Well, he knows what's wrong with me. Yeah, I know he does. And he's waiting for you to get the picture that he'll heal. That he'll heal you in 5 seconds. Can I just preach a few more minutes? A few more minutes. Now, remember what I just said. You will never possess what you will not pursue. Here's the key. And you will not pursue what you're not persuaded about. Until you're persuaded, you don't go after it. We are on a fool's journey. We, not you. We are on a fool's journey. If we think we're some kind of Pentecostal prima donna and God's just going to show up where we're sitting. Oh, no. He's looking for worshipers. He's looking for praisers. I'm not sitting next to somebody that doesn't worship. I'm not sitting next to somebody that doesn't clap, doesn't sing, because the potentate is on the prowl, and the potentate wants to bless people. I'm trying to get to my sermon. I can't see. What I told you before was God never made anything with his mouth shut. Let me tell you part two. God has never created anything unless he first had a picture. He declares the things that are not as though they were. I've asked all over the Pentecostal movement. I haven't got the answer from anybody yet. When it says he declared the things that are not, I asked lots of them. I said, not what? And they look at me, what? I said, not what? He declares the things that are not. Not what? I got to answer my own question. Not yet manifested. But he declares them because they're in his mind as a picture. Remember this. The architect has the building already completed before the first nail is driven. The first cinder block is laid. God is the universe's master architect. He's got the whole thing finished in his head before he ever starts doing it. If you can accept this, your healing is a done deal. Your deliverance is a done deal. It's already done in the mind of God. He's waiting for you to get the picture. You got to hear me, folks. The deal is already done before it's done. You got to get the picture. Jesus went to get beat half to death at Pilate's hall. Why? So that you could have healing in the atonement. He went to Calvary. Why? Get the picture. So our sins could be forgiven. He ascended on high and came back in spirit form at Pentecost so we could have the Holy Ghost. Get the picture. Look at your neighbor and say, he's for me. Oh, that was too wussified. He's for me. He's for me. I'm coming out of this. I don't know when, I don't know how, but I will come out of this. You can be seated. Kind of, I wish I had time. I was going to get to the story of the woman with the issue of blood. I don't want to hurt your feelings. Sometimes we got to lose our image to get our answer. Sometimes we got to act crazy to experience deliverance. Sometimes we got to tear off the roof so we can get our healing and our mercy. We cannot go to church and just act pretty and cute. Sometimes you're fighting devils and demons and discouragement and despair and frustration and unanswered prayers. Sometimes, here we go, young people, you got to bust a move, baby. You just got to bust a move. You got to push somebody out of your way and say, get out of my way. You don't need an answer. Jesus is passing by. I got to have an answer. There's healing right now in this house. I sense the gift of faith working. If you need something right now, throw your hands up and believe. Get a picture. Picture yourself as being touched. Picture yourself as being delivered. Picture yourself as receiving mercy. Hey, Brother Poe, you know how Bartimaeus got healed? He was a blind man, but he had a picture. He could not see naturally, but he could see spiritually. Together, Bishop, watch this. Just remain standing. I'm not going to try to out-preach myself. Just watch. Bartimaeus is sitting on the road begging. He's blind. He can't see beans. Watch what it says. And when he heard it was Jesus of Nazareth. Boy, that's a sermon to preach. You only see by hearing. Faith comes by hearing. hearing by the word of God. When he heard it was Jesus, his hidden eye said, that's the healer. That's the miracle worker. That's the sea walker. That's the Lazarus raiser. That's the devil chaser. That's the Lord of glory. That's the one that speaks, hey, Jesus! Come on, let the picture provoke your faith right now. Get a picture. I'm going to be healed. This sickness is going to leave me. Repeat after me. Picture first. Girl, you see this right here? You see this? She knelt down over there. When she knelt down over there, I felt the Lord just quicken me and says, you snatch that off her and I'll make that neck well. Release your faith. Release your faith. Let your picture give birth to your performance. I'm not preaching no more. Now it's in your ballpark. What are you going to do with what you have heard?